जा, ये जिंदगी है कौम की, तो कौम पे लुटाए जा, कदम कदम बढ़ाए जा, खुशी के गीत गाए जा, ये जिंदगी है कौम की। दुश्मनों का सर तुझे वतन बढ़ाए जा। तुझे रे हिंद आगे बढ़, मरने से फिर भी तू न डर। उड़ा के दुश्मनों का सर तुझे वतन बढ़ाए जा।
देवेश, am I audible? Ah, now you can speak now. Jain Devish.
பாடலில் கம்பனி பிரிய சரவணனே காஷ்மீர் மண்ணை உடலினில் சுமந்து குமரியில் கரைத்தவனே இறந்தும் 40 நாட்களும் காவல் காத்த
ஆனதங்கே
மையன மாறி சரித்திரம் எழுதிடுமே.
வெல்கம் பண்ண Yes, Devesh, you are audible. As a tribute to Major Mariappan Saravanan, Veer Chakra Posthumous, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to Lieutenant Commander Lalit Kumar Siya, the Commanding Officer of 4TA Naval Technical Unit NCC, as well as the officers, PA staffs, ANOs, NCC cadets, professors, and students to this event. Before we get started with the webinar, I would like to give some instructions. If you have any queries regarding the topic, type them in the chat box, or else you can unmute yourself and ask at the end of the session. Now we will move on to the session. Let me give a short intro about மேஜர் மாரியப்பன் சரவணன் போஸ்ட்மஸ். மேஜர் மாரியப்பன் சரவணன் போஸ்ட்மஸ் வாஸ் அன் ஆஃபீஸர் இன் த ப்ரெஸ்டீஜியஸ் பீகார் ரெஜிமெண்ட் ஆஃப் த இண்டியன் ஆர்மி. வாஸ் மார்ட்டர்ட் டியூரிங் த கார்கில் வார். வாஸ் கில்ட் இன் ஹேண்ட் டு ஹேண்ட் காம்பேட் வித் இன்ட்ரூடர்ஸ் ஆஃப்டர் கில்லிங் ஃபோர் இன்ட்ரூடர்ஸ் இன் த பட்டாலிக் ஏரியா ஆஃப் கார்கில் செக்டார் ஆன் 29th May 1999. இஸ் ஆல்சோ நோன் அஸ் த ஹீரோ ஆஃப் பட்டாலிக் விச் இஸ் நன் அதர் தன் ஆர் டாபிக் ஆர் வெபினார் கால். He was awarded the Veer Chakra, an Indian gallantry award presented for the acts of gallantry in the presence of the enemy on the battlefield. Now we are pleased to welcome Captain S.V. Ramsundar, the guest speaker of today's session. Welcome, sir. I would like to give a short intro about our guest speaker, Captain S.V. Ramsundar. Captain S.V. Ramsundar is an ex-army professional with nearly 2 years of rich team management experience in operations, HR, security and administration across diverse industries. He has 6 years of experience in Indian Army and 11 years of corporate experience and 5 years experience in Southern Railways. He has acute business management course from IIM Indore. He has been awarded a Talent of the Year 2012 and Leader of the Year 2014. In IAS and SDB Security Services Private Limited. He actively participated in rescue and relief work during the 2015 massive flood in Chennai and also giving a career counseling and test preparation classes for school and college students. Welcome, sir.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you. Thank you, Devish, for the introduction. Jain.
Jain, sir.
Good morning to everybody. It is indeed a privilege and honor to be addressing such an august presence and also to talk about Major Saravanan Veer Chakra. It is indeed a very noble profession, the arms. The service for your country is the most noble profession. And people who chose their lives over the safety and security of their country always need to be kept in mind. So today is a very solemn day for all of us, where we remember and pay our tributes to Major Saravanan. I still remember when the Kargil war happened. I was an youngster. I was actually working in Trichy, and I had seen the emotions in Trichy when the when Major Mariappan was martyred in action. So nobody wants war, but then when it comes, how we take it upon is what a country is known for. Since the audience is also I would also take anecdotes and take the liberty of speaking in Tamil. So we have also seen that in the Sangam literature, what we called the Sangha Ilakkiyangal, the act of bravery or valor was always upheld. It was even said that where a person who had a wound in his back, he would not get a proper cremation or he would not get a proper welcome by his own family. So that is the tradition of this land. So we come from such a place where history is full of examples of heroes who always fought for the what was right for this land. So in such a background scenario, when we talk about Major Saravanan, I would like to probably say a little more about his personal life. In this era of internet, it is more easier to find from Google and all this stuff. So mine is also mostly of that, but I also have tried and interacted with few of his college mates, his unit officers, and try to see if I can make justice to give you a little more information what Google would throw to you. So if you see his early life, he was born to Colonel Mariappan. Lieutenant Colonel Mariappan himself was an officer in the Army Medical Corps, And he was also, you know, he was taking part in the IPKF, and unfortunately we lost him when he was serving in IPKF, when Major Saravanan was very young. Mr. Samardavalli is Major Saravanan's mother, and he has got two sisters. So he was born in Rameshwaram, and being a Fauji kid, being an army officer's son, so he has studied and traveled across the country, and it is, you know, very natural for him to develop interest towards the army life. So so that is the, I mean, we also find that during his education, he was also the student union leader in St. Joseph's College, which is, you know, worth mentioning here. And he has also, the leadership traits have also been, you know, we can see it right from his earlier age. He was a C certificate holder in the NCC infantry unit there. And you know, we all need to understand that when Major Saravanan took this decision of sacrificing his life, he was just 27. So, and what, you know, motivates people to do this is what we will see through this, you know, through this lecture, what you're going to have. So after, you know, during his college, definitely he was trying for his NDA, and probably after that, and he joined OTA, and he graduated, he got commissioned from the OTA in 1995 in the 1st Battalion of the BR Regiment, one of the most decorated regiments of the Army. And my own SEO of, you know, when I got commissioned, he is also commissioned into the same battalion, 1st Battalion of BR Regiment. And after joining the Army, he had served in places like Tamulpur, Kuch Bihar, Bhutan, you know, mostly on the eastern side. And then his unit during the Kargil operations was moved suddenly from the eastern side to, and inducted into the Kargil war. So the time of the incidences, what happened during Major Saravanan's tryst with, you know, eliminating the enemy from the Batalik area, was in the very early stages of the war, early stages of the conflict. Probably he was martyred on May 29th. So May 29th was actually too early a period in the conflict when not much of the forces coming, you know, committed. There was very little, you know, artillery support and air support because of the logistics. You know, there were certain restrictions or certain issues with the logistics, as well as the, so, you know, we also have to understand the nature of the terrain. So in this particular task, when Major Saravanan's, actually he volunteered for the task because it was the third attempt of the unit to capture the particular objective. So he volunteered to capture a well-fortified Pakistani position at a height of 14,229 feet in the Batalik sector. The enemy was well entrenched, it was a well-fortified structure. They had artillery support, they had automatic weapons, and they were sitting on top. So that was the, you know, the kind of, you know, the enemy, strong portion of the enemy was, and how we were attacking. So it was but obvious for Major Saravanan that even before the attack would happen, he would have definitely realized that he would have to sacrifice his life that day. So here, I just want you all to, you know, understand the background of this particular moment when a man who's 27 years old, who has, you know, just been inducted from East into Kargil, how, what is the, you know, ground reality. We need to understand the mindset. I've read in the internet also that on the 14th or 15th of May, he writes to his mother saying that, "Mother, I will come back with a Veer Chakra." Similar also examples there, particularly in the Kargil war, where we have seen that men who were about to go to war had already known that, you know, they are going to sacrifice their lives in this particular operations. You know, I would draw a similar parallel to, you know, this great spiritual, you know, spiritual men of various religions who definitely knew what they wanted to do with their life, or when they would even, you know, leave this mortal body and attain the higher positions. So similar to this, all these men, officers and men who lost their lives in this particular conflict, we need to understand how it happened. first of all, the average height of this place was more than 12,000, 13,000 feet. So all the inductors who were inducted into the particular sector or the particular theater were had come from other places where, because of logistics constraints, so many number of troops could not be properly acclimatized or given the necessary equipments. But we as a army is one of the, you know, fittest and the best army in the world. This is not something which is going to stop us. Yes, our men, our officers, everything was ready to take on the task. But then the biggest hurdle of all this was the terrain and the climate. The temperature used to be on the top. As you go higher and higher, closer to the top where you need to fight, it used to be from minus 8 to minus 11 degrees Celsius. And mind me that it was a barren, rocky terrain. And enemy sitting on top of you, well entrenched. He has got his bunkers, everything ready, with his automatic weapons sighted to exactly pointed at you when you'll attack. And he also had artillery support, indirect artillery fire from behind, which could drop, you know, hundreds and, you know, quintals and tons of bombs, shells at the attacking Indian troops. So first of all, the climate was against us. We had to go uphill, and that too in high altitude at this freezing temperatures and without much of the artillery support from our side. So all these men who were directly attacking, the frontal attack of all this post were very difficult. So it was but inevitable that many of them knew that they will be sacrificing their life very soon. Like how Major Saravanan told his mother that he'll be coming back with the Veer Chakra, it indirectly meant that he might attempt martyrdom. Similarly, there were a few officers who had written to their parents saying that, my dear mother, my dear father, when you receive this letter, I'll be watching you from skies and I'll be happy for you when you see this letter. So do not cry or do not feel bad about this. I'm very happy to do this. So that was the kind of mindset when men went into this particular conflict, or for that matter, any conflict. So that is what, you know, it makes it, you know, we all need to understand the mindset of people, what drives people to such a extent we are able to lay down their lives. So, you know, that is the we all need to know that the Kargil conflict especially got a lot of media attention later after some time, probably June or mid-June. But the one Major Saravanan was probably one of the few officers who had fallen in the earlier stages of the war. And in this particular attack where he had was leading, there were huge loss of men, there were huge loss of losses happening. And in spite of being told to fall back, his code name was Genghis in this particular operation. So he told his boss, so nothing will happen to Genghis, that he will take it on. He was able to neutralize two bunkers, but then he was injured and very severely injured, that he was killed in the fight. Now the particular place was so difficult for attack that it took 37 days for us to retrieve the bodies from the particular place. This gave a very big fighting, you know, resolve for the battalion to snatch the objective from the enemy at a very short duration. So these sacrifices need to be, you know, glorified and emulated so that we all are ready for, you know, such a kind of sacrifices, such a kind of training that is necessary, such a kind of mindset, that spirit that we need to inculcate in us, in others, so that we are able to withstand any kind of aggression from any of our neighbors. You know, given the current timings, given the current situation, we know that, you know, now we see that this is particularly, I would say, that the current pandemic is almost like a boy war which is being waged inside the country. So now everybody inside the country is actually, you know, fighting this war. It is not just the people in the borders, the doctors, the nurses, the frontline workers, everybody is fighting this war. So at such a kind of a time, everybody need to understand this mindset and be very sensible and be very proactive. You know, I just again want you all to, you know, take back your, you know, mind and attention towards the fact that what would a person feel when he knows that his task is to capture an objective by 4 o'clock in the morning. And he would know that once this objective, you know, when they start attacking at probably say 4, he know that by, you know, half an hour or 1 hour they may be gone. And what would he be, you know, thinking the night previous to that? What makes men resolve so hard and to fight, still fight and win, or fight and lead men into, you know, at times certain death? So the point is, it is the self-honor, the honor for themselves, the honor of their unit for which they are serving, their battalions, their, you know, regiments, the patriotism for this country, for their motherland. So these are all the things, you know, once a choice is made, you are bound to it and the task has to be fulfilled at any cost. So that is the kind of resolve that we all need to have. It is not just for the, you know, armed forces, or for only for the people in the armed, you know, forces. It is for everybody out in the, you know, world. Whether you're a whatever job you may be doing, whether you're a doctor, engineer, advocate, software, you know, engineer, or for that matter, any kind of a profession. Once you have chosen it, do it and do it well. So in a normal job, it could only be, you know, sacrificing your sleep. But if you join the profession of arms, see, profession of arms, when you join the, you know, any of the military services, it is not a job. It's a way of life. Only people who have worn a uniform will understand what it means. The pride of wearing a uniform, what it means that it's a way of life. Once you wear a uniform, you become a soldier and soldier for life. And it's a very, very, very rare opportunity that anybody could get in this life. And I'm 100% sure that anybody who's worn a uniform would definitely want to be born again and again to don the same uniform. That is the pride and magic of that particular, you know, profession. It is not a job, it's a way of life. So to be, you know, if you think that we need to be worthy of it, there are certain habits, there are certain values that we need to inculcate in us and be, you know, worthy of it. At this point of time, you know, when we all, you know, remember about Major Saravanan, so we all see all these ideals in him. And that was an era when in 1999, there was so much of hardships. There was only hardships when all these battalions were pressed into action. We were suddenly, you know, caught unawares. There was logistical bottlenecks, lack of equipment, lack of artillery support, lack of air support. But that did not deter, that did not pull down the morale of our men, of our officers, to face the enemy who was very well entrenched. Our idea was to teach them a lesson, what they deserve, what they've always deserved. So, talking about Major Saravanan, we all know that the family of Major Saravanan, they have this Major Saravanan Memorial Trust, and it's a public charitable trust, which, you know, for to immortalize the name of the great martyr. So we have the his statue installed in Trichy, and I have also, you know, been there, and it's a pride, you know, for me, first of all, as a army man, to, you know, to talk about him. To have gone to his the place where his statue is kept, and I have, you know, paid my respects to that, to him, and I just wish that, you know, his sacrifice does not go waste in the things that we need to build up that national fervor in us. The ideals for which men sacrificed their life was for an idea called a motherland, which is called India, which is secular, which is pluralistic, which is so dynamic and which is ever growing. To be proud to be born in this country, to be proud to be, you know, serving in a in an organization like one of our, you know, services, the military services, either the Army, Air Force, or the Navy. So at this point of time, we all need to understand that when we, you know, take a vow, or when we take a resolve that we were going to respect our martyrs, that is how this nation is going to go forward. Only when you respect the sacrifices made by the men for your country is respected, that this country will further develop and progress. There is no doubt about that. So I'm, you know, so very happy that the JPR Engineering College, along with the NCC, has organized for this talk on remembering, you know, Major Saravanan on this day of martyrdom, and such. We are looking forward to such talks and such speeches, so that it brings us, the youth, closer towards the ideals of this nation, this nationhood. This nation is an idea which has been formed, you know, very recently, and we need to take it on, and we need to be the torchbearers to take it forward. And we have always shown light to this world in any field you want, whether it was science, spirituality, or, you know, any field you name, this country has always been there. And especially when I'm talking to particularly about the armed forces, especially in the south, there is a lack of awareness of what happens in the defense forces. Unfortunately, there are less number of defense establishments. We have not seen probably a war for a very long time. We were not affected by, you know, World War I or World War II. Probably the last war either could have fought here was between the British and the French, or between the, you know, the British and the Nawab, the kind of war, maybe 200, 300 years back. Though most of our men from South are there in the defense services, but the general public does not have a kind of awareness about what the defense forces is, the higher ideals of what it is, how we need to look at the armed forces, how we need to respect them, how we need to motivate our people to join the armed forces and, you know, serve the nation. And probably we all know that, you know, we are one of the largest voluntary armies in the world. Nobody is forced. Probably in many other countries, people are forced to join their armies for some reasons or the other. We all have to remember that Indian Army is one of the largest standing army, and that too a voluntary army, and one of the best, the bravest armies in the world. So I believe, you know, it's all a, you know, matter of proud for us that, you know, we belong to this country, and this particular country and this particular, you know, army has been able to produce officers and men like Major Saravanan, who are ready to sacrifice their lives for their nation. I mean, this is what I had to say. I'm done. If you know, anybody wants to ask me any question, you can ask me.
Jain sir, all the participants can ask their queries in their live chat, and it will be explained by our speaker, sir. Sir, all the participants can ask their queries in their live chat, and it will be explained by our speaker, sir. morning, sir. Sir, there is a query from James Zion. He's asking, sir, can you explain about short-term commission in defense, sir? Am I audible, sir?
Yes, yes. Yeah, thanks. See, short service commission in the army now is open, you know, like you have to be a graduate, you apply for the Combined Defense Services examination. And then post your selection in the Combined Defense Services examination, you can apply for, through the UPSC, you can apply for UPSC examination. Then you have a written examination, which I feel it's pretty, easier for us all of us to clear. And then there will be a Services Selection Board interview. Once you clear the Services Selection Board interview, then you can, you'll get an order to join the Army, and then you can join the Officer Training Academy to become a commissioned officer.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. And there is another query from Dilip Paradesh, sir.
Yes.
What is the maximum required years for the retirement in Army? He's asking about retirement in Army. Maximum years for the retirement.
See, okay. What happens is you can serve, minimum for pension, minimum you need to serve 20 years. Other than that, you can serve till 58.
Yes, sir. And there is a query from Hagamat Salman, sir. Mm-hmm. What is the reason you think that not many people join defense forces from Tamil Nadu? How can we bring awareness about it, sir?
That's a wonderful question. Good. So, see, that's what I said. No, what happens is there. First of all, I personally believe that if some of you are in Chennai, do you know where this OTA is? Many of us won't know where OTA is, Officer Training Academy. See, in India, there are only two institutions, the OTA and the IMA, or which trains officers, right? Officer cadets. One is in Dehradun, IMA Dehradun. For Dehradun, IMA is an iconic place. Whereas if you get down at Central Station, Madras Central Station, and ask for a auto guy, where is OTA? Probably he may not know. But it's one of the most, premium training institutes of the country. So that is what, in South generally, the number of established officers are less. And since we have not undergone any, conflicts in the recent past, probably people are not aware what it is. And there is generally, I would say, there is generally a belief of, there is generally a fear of joining the defense. But it is not that. If you really ask me, most of the recruitment rallies for Jawans, it is fully subscribed. I think we'll find, more number of people are applying to become soldiers, to join the army. But when it comes to joining the officer's cadre, I think there is a kind of a shortfall. So for that, the reason I believe is the number of people wanting to take defense services as a profession is less, because they are not aware of what the life of the defense officer is. So once you understand, see, the number of people dying on road accident, the percentage of people dying on road accidents is much, much, much higher than the people getting martyred in defense, for a quick, kind of a comparison. So there has to be no reason for, probably maybe people might think the life, probably one is the, fear of death. But I don't feel so. We are coming from a country which has got this tradition. That is not the main reason. Probably they are not comfortable serving very much away from the home. Probably I feel that is one of the main reasons. People think that if you are in the defense, you'll be posted far away from your, home. People want to stay closer, closer home and not move further away. And another thing which I feel is could be the language barrier, because they might probably think, if once you join the army, probably you might be expected to, converse or know more of Hindi. So if you really ask me, in my case, I had learned Hindi, after joining the army. So that is again no great shakes. And now, so these are probably the reasons why people are not aware of the defense institutions. But I certainly believe that the defense institutions, the Dakshin Bharat area, the setup here. They are all trying to make it as visible, as vocal as to the students, so that the younger generation is aware of the defense services and motivate people to join the defense services. And now, how do we do it? This particular event we are having now is just an example. I think we need to have more such examples where the awareness is increased about what has happened and how it is happening in the defense. So we just need to be more aware of what is happening around the country. As youngsters, please visit the UPSC website, which has the notifications for the joining for the various defense positions. It is through the one is your NDA Naval Academy entrance, then is your Combined Defense Services examinations. So you can go through that. These details keep changing at times. So the latest ones you can download from the, or you can look at the particular website and know for yourself. And if there is any doubt, of course, we are all there to guide you to know more about it. And awareness can be brought more. I probably believe there is a very less media coverage of what happens in the defense, because media generally, not media, the human mind generally is more focused towards negativity. So if we see, that is the reason negativity gets more attraction, or negativity gets more TRP ratings, and negativity gets shown more. But the kind of positive things that happens in defense, the kind of the way of life you're going to have when you join the defense is not known to many of us. The level of training, you will keep studying till you retire. You will keep yourself fit. Your compensation, your after retirement benefits, and most of all, the pride of serving in defense is something which cannot be which you will not get in any other profession. So I think these are the things which need to be highlighted often to our boys and girls, so that they understand how these things are, and we will probably we'll try and increase this awareness through various sources, through various means. So to be more specific about the previous question that you had asked, so the short service commission now is for 10 to 14 years. So first you have to serve for 10 years, and after the 10th year you have got three options: either go for permanent commission, or to come out, or have the option of extension for 4 more years. So in this 4 more years, at any point of time you can resign. So when you resign and come out of the army, you have to understand that the army will make you fully equipped to come to the civil world and get a job. You probably would try to get a seat in a premier management institute, where you'll go for a 6 months residential course, so that you know what is business management, and you'll get easily picked up by any of the corporate companies, like how it happened to me. So I joined the Indian Institute of Management in Indore, and I was picked up in the campus during the subprime crisis. Even though it was a subprime crisis happened, probably for the defense officer there was not such any problem. We all got our placement, and then we joined the civil life. So I hope I have answered you.
Yeah, sir, it's a very good answer, a brief answer, sir. So one more thing, sir. What is the age we need to join in Indian Air Force and qualification to join? It's from Bhavesh Joshi, sir.
Pardon me, Devesh, I had to just step out for a minute. Yeah, please, sir.
No problems. So what is the age we need to join in Indian Air Force and qualification to join? It's from Bhavesh Joshi, sir. Excuse me, sir, you are not audible, sir.
Yeah, can you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, yes, sir, sure. What is the age we need to join in Indian Air Force and qualification to join, sir? Asking the Air Force qualification for joining Indian Air Force.
Yeah, I understood. See, when it comes to the joining the Air Force, See, we all have to understand that there are two, you know, there is always, you know, the entry is separate for the men and officers. Correct. So if you're talking about officers, so then that'll, the age is, you know, probably after, there are two ways of, you know, first of all, we all have to understand that after your 12th standard, you can go to NDA. So after, right after your 12th standard, you can join the National Defense Academy. Now, National Defense Academy is a feeder academy to your IMA or to your Air Force Academy or to your, you know, the naval establishments where they will become officers later. So in the NDA, you are actually doing your graduation, your 3-year graduation, depending upon the, you know, stream you take. So you will be that is one way to join the defense forces just after your 12th standard. So that is one way. So that is just after your schooling. So that you need to keep on looking at the, you know, the notifications in UPSC website when you are in the middle of your 12th standard. That is one way. The other one is after your graduation. So especially if you're wanting to join the Air Force, I would first request you all to go through the Career Indian Air Force. There is a website developed by CDAC. It's called Career Indian Air Force, CDAC.in. In case of the Air Force, so we need to understand that when you're planning to join the Air Force as an officer,
yes sir.
Yeah. So
sir, another query. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes, yeah, please.
Yeah, another query, sir. From Muthu Lakshmi Kumar, sir, you said in recent times we have not seen a war. What do you think the reason for that, sir? Is that major countries not willing to go for a war, or many countries are powered well? What do you think about this statement, sir?
No. What I meant that we have not seen war in the recent past is, I was only mentioning about South India. In the south of, you know, when you come down south of this side of Rajasthan or this side of West Bengal, there has not been any war where there has not been any civilian interaction with war, is what I meant. Okay, that is one part. So that generally, what happens is, in places like Rajasthan and Punjab, where they share the international boundary with Pakistan, so they really understand the seriousness and the importance of defense forces and how the life is of all those people, because they generally, you know, rub their shoulders. So what we are, you know, trying to, you know, understand from this particular thing was, that is the reason probably we are not able to understand this, the awareness of defense amongst the southern states are less, is what I meant. But what you're saying about the war not happening, see, there is war actually happening every day. As we speak, there could be, you know, operations happening in counterinsurgency in Jammu and Kashmir, in the northeastern part of the country, you know, or anywhere where people are actively involved or actively deployed in the forward areas. Wherever there is a field area and where people are actively involved, there is actually a lot of activity happening. So we are in a state of alertness and we are in a state of operation ready every time. It is not there, you know, only when a, you know, see, now the war or the way how a war is conducted happening has completely changed from what it was. Earlier, we knew there was an enemy and we could fight only during the day. There were no night fighting capabilities. Then further, the cyber thing has come, now the biological angle has come. So there is war always happening. So using the traditional assets of the defense, your arms, your equipments, your ships, your aircrafts, your tanks, your artillery guns may not be happening every day or may not be happening at every war. War, the way it happens now, the way it is going to happen in the future is going to be totally different. So what we need to now understand is, there's a new, you know, kind of, you know, avenues opening. There is a lot of, you know, cyber warfare kind of a thing which is happening. There's a lot of warfare, which is will open up a new in a new perspective called space. In the space, there could be a race for, you know, some kind of dominance, because now we are trying to, you know, go to Moon or Mars. So those are the, you know, new avenues where the these things are, you know, opening up. So the bigger countries, their assets are always deployed. They're always ready to move. It is not, nobody has cut their defense budget. Nobody has reduced the spending on the, you know, purchase of arms and ammunition. It keeps on going. Maybe everything is kept ready for an eventuality, but the minor skirmishes may not happen like earlier.
Yeah, sir. Sir, one more query, sir. It's from Bhuvanesh P. from JECNCC, sir. What are the officer-like qualities to clear SSB interview, sir?
See, let me tell you one thing. The OLQs, or the officer-like qualities, is a very, very, you know, it's a very, I would say, a very difficult term to define or explain. See, understand that the selection for the officers in the Indian Army is totally, you know, different, correct? See, when I joined, when I appeared for my SSB in Bhopal, I was serving in railways. After my 12th standard, I joined railways as a clerk. So I was working in railways for 5 years. I did my graduation through correspondence. And after my completing my graduation, then I applied for various other jobs, and defense was very close to my heart. So luckily, you know, I got for the call for SSB after clearing the CDS examination. So when I went for the SSB, it is not, you know, they are looking, you know, your OLQs, you know, an OLQ is one thing which even if you know, you cannot inculcate into you. There are certain suitabilities. See, what I'm trying to say is, tomorrow, even if you get don't get selected in the SSB, that does not mean that you're rejected. Please understand that. I can tell you names of people who have got not selected by SSB, very big people, even probably Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam or Amitabh Bachchan or Shah Rukh Khan. Maybe these are all the people who could have been not selected by SSB. So it is the OLQs, the how it is measured. It's a very holistic approach. They're looking at a person who's normal, who's intelligent enough, who will be able to work cohesively in a unit, and who can accomplish a mission. You know, that is like, it cannot be defined. It varies to person to person. Correct? You might know the answer for it. You might know what it is, but are you really having it? Will it come out of you in terms of stress? If you look at the tests which are conducted in SSB, the tests which happen in the SSB are mostly, you'll be put into a little bit of stress to see that what really comes out of you under stress. What comes out of you under stress, if you're able to demonstrate, if you're able to exhibit those OLQs, then you'll be considered. And with regard to OLQs, you know, it is available everywhere on the internet. It is available in every other coaching institute. But a lot of introspection has to go into you. A lot of genuine, frank introspection about your own self. It is like you talking to yourself, standing in front of a mirror and asking you, do you really have it in you? Right?
Yeah, sir. It's a very good answer from you, sir. And one more query, sir, from Sulakshana Lakshmanan. Sir, who can join the army? Can both girls and boys? She's asking whether both boys and girls are eligible to join an Indian army, or else should we take an Indian Air Force or Indian Navy like that?
Sir. No. See, in the army, women can join as officers. Now, I mean, it has been there in the early 90s that ladies are being inducted into the army. I'm talking about the army. So defense forces, even Navy and Air Force, they also have entries specially for ladies, I mean women. And in the army now, see, you would have seen in the airports, or you would have seen in CRPF and CASF, they have got women constables, correct? The other ranks. probably in the army, other rank entry for women is not there. But now they have started. They have now started with the core of military police. So military police has got its first, you know, recruits who are joining the core of military police as in the other ranks. So girls or ladies, the women can definitely join any of the defense forces, and their career progression or their equality in the particular three defense forces is day by day increasing. A grant of permanent commission to them, you know, we also have fighter pilots, we have got women fighter pilots with us. We have got officers in the army who are there deployed in the forward areas, in the engineers, in the air defense artillery. So, of course, in Navy too. So there is no differentiation as far as army is concerned, or as far as the defense forces is concerned for the intake of women. Probably the intake into the other ranks is less, only in the officers' cadres it is much, much more.
So thank you for your brief answer, sir. Hope Sulakshana will get an idea about how to, whether a woman can join in Indian Army or other forces too, sir. Hope they would have cleared their answer. And one more thing, sir. From Surya, what is the eligibility criteria for Central Cyber Force?
Central Cyber Force, I'm sorry, I'm not aware. Okay. Let me, maybe probably I'll try and check and let you know.
And one more query, sir, from Tamodar Reddy. Instead of encountering any terrorists, why are you simply arresting with these terrorists? May army people dead? Is he asking about something related to war-like situation, sir?
See, there are certain procedures and principles which the army armed forces have to follow. We cannot, it is not a movie, you know, in real life that you can kill somebody at your own will and wish. And see, you all have to understand that Indian army has got the highest, you know, or the most best traditions in the world. Like, you know, how you would see, you know, Dhoni in IPL, which team gets the highest, you know, the fair play award. So likewise, we play very fair, even in war. So for example, I can tell you various examples from various wars. Our forces were so good that United Nations, you know, we went into Korea as the peacekeeping force. We are the best, one of the best contingents in the world when it comes to United peacekeeping, you know, missions. And even in Kargil war also, initially Pakistan did not accept that it was their regular force. Their Northern Light Infantry officers and men were deployed as terrorists. They tried to tell to the world that it was their not their regular army, but it was their terrorists or the Mujahideens. But then finally, during the war, we recovered their ID cards. We understood that it was their regular force who were fighting. And like how we have our own brave men and brave officers, similarly, the Pakistani army did also have their own brave men and brave officers laying down their lives. So what we did was, we gave back their bodies in a very honorable way. And based on our references, our citations, one of their officers got their Nishane Haider. Their Nishane Haider is equivalent to our Paramveer Chakra. So we are a very disciplined, very morally right and a very upright kind of a force. You all would have known that, you know, in Kargil war, officers were captured by the Pakistanis as prisoners of war, were tortured and killed. You know, first Captain Nair, then there was other Air Force officer who was also, you know, shot down. They were all brutally tortured and their bodies were given to us. Whereas when we had captured them, or when we had, you know, recovered their bodies, we properly handed it over to them. That is the difference between us and others. Correct? So there is a way in which you have to fight a war. There is a way in which you adhere to the rules of any engagement. We never, as a very modern and a very disciplined force, we never do that. And when it comes to terrorists, there is a rule of law. What we are supposed to do, we will, if we capture a terrorist, we will take the course of law. Probably the person is misguided by the, you know, by the other people. So we will give him a fair chance to, for him to redesign his life, to understand better and relive his life. We don't have any right to kill anybody. We have only, and especially with terrorists, it's not a conventional war. You can kill people. In a conventional war, of course, it is there. We are there only to probably, neutralize the enemy, capture our objective. That is a different ball game altogether. When it comes to terrorism, it's a different ball game altogether. We are operating in our own land. We are probably trying to, probably these terrorists could be our own brothers and sisters. So we cannot be very, high-handed and act in a way which is not good for others.
Yeah, sir. It's really appreciable by our Indian Army. And one more thing, Tamodar Reddy, I would like to answer you because you mark my words, our former Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, has stated that in Panchashil, India is always a peacemaking country. See, just like that, we cannot have a war. War is always a secondary for Indian government. Because just like that, we can't, as sir said, cinema, it cannot be implemented, war cannot be implemented or initiated. It cannot be declared as soon as everything. We have to think and we have to, all the procedures has to be followed. Like that, Indian Army and Pakistani Army, there is a difference between all over the country. Because Indian Army has its own tradition and they're privileged and it will be a great army. That's why Indian Army is the third largest army in the world. And it is a prestigious army that every country would know that India has a very strong defense system and we could definitely fight. But this is not the only case that we should fight for a war. War will not be declared unless it is a very critical situation. Hope you would have understood Damodar Reddy from sir's explanation and also just given by me. And there is one more query, sir, from Suresh. Can anyone join territorial army? If not, are there any prerequisite qualification and experience to join? TA, mandatory service criterion, if any, per year of service to rendered, etc.
See, territorial army, I'll have to check and come back to you. It probably will be available on the net. So I'll check and get back to you on that. And similarly, with regard to Bhavesh question on joining the Indian Air Force also. See, what happens is, one way to join the Air Force is, there is as I told you, the NDA examination is there, which is released twice a year in the month of June and December, and CDS in the month of July and November. So NDA, as I told you, is to join NDA after your 12th standard, and CDSE is after your graduation. So in the Air Force, and also you have got the Air Force common, admission test. So for other entries other than NDA and CDSE for all branches, so this test is conducted twice a year in February and August. So that AFCAT is also out in June and December. And similarly, there is an NCC entry for C certificate holders through NCC special entry. Then after that, you'll have your Air Force selection board and your stage 2 testing and then your medicals and similar kind of test. So for the specific inputs with regard to it could be as per your qualification. Like probably I can get one-on-one with Bhavesh, try and understand what is his qualification. As a graduate, your eligibility criteria to join the appear for the CDSE is for the flying branch, say it is 20 to 24, okay, and it is permanent commission and it is for men. Then for men and women, special entry is the NCC special entry is there. So similarly, the Air Force common entrance test is there for the short service commission and flying branch. So there are various kinds of entries, and generally the age group is 20 to 24, right? And then also your educational qualification also will come into play. I hope I have answered for Bhavesh's question. So this is probably, as I told you, you can get into the website of careerindianairforce.cdac.in. Yes, Devish.
So once again, sir. So once again, sir, I got disconnected from YouTube live. I will get back to you in few seconds.
Sir, good morning, sir. Sir, I am NC1S Dilip Pardesh. Sorry for the interruption, sir. Devish is just disconnected now.
No issue.
Sir, we will go on to the question section, sir. There is a question that they asked Jairaj. Is it necessary to go for a SSB coaching center to clear SSB, sir?
It's an individual choice. I would say, I would not say you should go or you should not go. Many people have cleared the SSB, thing without attending the coaching also. Some have attended and cleared also. Many have attended and not cleared it also. So it is up to you. It is like, sir, should I, go for a, tuition kind of a thing. I'll tell you one thing. If you are made for it, you will definitely get through it even without the coaching. But if in case you feel that you need to, sharpen your some, skills or something, or you want to rather familiarize yourself as to how this particular whole, SSB coaching or evaluation happens, it's better that you will have a understand of, you'll have a better understanding of what is going to happen in those 5 days when you reach there.
Yes, sir, the logical answer, sir. And there is another question from Bhavesh Joshi. Sir, he's studying in 12th standard now, and they didn't tell anything about the new exams. But the NDA application will be start from the next month. So he is asking that he can apply from now, or I should wait for the next exam, sir.
No. The NDA notification which comes in CDS is probably pretty clear. It says that even people who are appearing for 12th standard examination also can appear. So, see, the point is when you are joining NDA or something, there is a cutoff date. By that date, your examination should have been over and you should have got your, pass certificate or whatever.
So, thank you, sir. Bhavesh Joshi will understand that. And I think Devesh D has been connected, sir. He will carry on the session, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Devesh, you can carry on the session.
Dilip. Okay, Jain Dilip. Hope that all the viewers would have enjoyed its session, and hope it would be a tribute to Major Mariappan Saravanan sir, Pichakra. And all the viewers had asked their questions and queries regarding their doubts in defense forces. Hope all the viewers would have got an idea about the defense jobs, and defense, as sir said, it is not a job, it is a way of life. So I request everyone to give a tribute to late Major Mariappan Veer Chakra, and hope this webinar would have been informative, and it is a great, it's an honor to JPR Engineering College, the NCC cadets, to take up these kind of webinars and do their little bit contribution to our defense people. It's my privilege to propose the vote of thanks. With the blessings of late Colonel Dr. JPR, founder of JPR Educational Trust, we have completed the webinar successfully. and I would like to express my gratitude to Dr. M. Regina JPR, the Chairman and Managing Director of JPR Group of Institutions, and Dr. V. Natarajan, the Principal of JPR Engineering College, for supporting this initiative. I also wish to express my gratitude to Lieutenant Commander Lalit Kumar CR, the Commanding Officer of 4th Naval Technical Unit NCC, for encouraging us to conduct this event. I convey my heartfelt gratitude to Captain S.V. Ramchandra Sir for gracing his presence and sharing his valuable thoughts with us. I would like to convey my sincere thanks to all the officers, PA staffs, ANOs, NCC cadets, professors and students, and all the participants for making this event a grand success. Now I request everyone to fill up the feedback form posted in the chat box before leaving the meeting. Jain Sir, and Jain all the participants and all the viewers. Hope it would have been an informative webinar. Thank you very much.
Jain, thank you.
Jain sir.
Jain sir.